Let's start with application of derivatives. In this chapter, we will learn the application of differentiation which we used previously. So, there are five types of function which I am going to tell you. First one is this, which is said to be increasing function. Second one, this, which is said to be strictly increasing function. Third one is this, which is said to be decreasing function. And fourth one, this strictly decreasing function. Last one, let's say this, which is called neither decreasing, neither increasing, nor decreasing function. Now, in the increasing function, you can see that it is constant for some time. In the strictly increasing function, you can see it's always increasing, neither constant nor decreasing. Okay. In the decreasing function, it is constant for some time, but it is decreasing for the other time. In the strictly decreasing function, it is always decreasing, neither constant nor increasing, nor decreasing. Okay. So, neither increasing nor decreasing, it's increasing also. It may be constant for some time, it may be decreasing. So, that's neither increasing nor decreasing function. Now, next we are going to learn the equation of tangent and normal. The equation of tangent and normal. Equation of tangent and normal. Tangent at x1, y1. At this point is given by y minus y1 is equals to f dash x1 x minus x1, where f dash x1 is real and normal at x1 comma y1 is given by y minus y1 is equals to minus 1 upon f dash x1 x minus x1, when f dash x1 is f dash x1 is non-zero. Okay, it should not be zero because it is in the denominator. Is non-zero real? Why is that? Because f dash x1 is the, here f dash x1 is the slope of the line made at x1, y1. Okay, so it is the slope, so y minus y1 into f dash x1, x minus x1 is the tangent. If you inverse, if you take the reciprocal of it and put a negative sign in front of it, it will become the slope of a normal. Okay, for tangent you use f dash x1, for normal you use minus 1 by f dash x1. So this is the theory for equation of tangent and normal. Now we are going to study tangent from an external point. Now, given a point P, A, comma, B, which does not lie on the curve y equals to fx, okay? Let's say this is the curve y equals to fx, and there is a point P, A, comma, B, which does not lie on the curve y equals to fx. Then the equation of possible tangents to the curve y equals to fx from this point, like you may say, this one. Okay, this is the tangent because it is touching at one point. So that's the tangent. And the normal will be like this. Okay, this is a kind of a normal because it's perpendicular to some tangent on this curve. So that's why it is normal. But tangent from this external point PA comma B will be at some point Q. Okay, and this is called the point of contact. Okay, this is called point of contact. Now let's say this is K comma F of K, right? Because if you put x is equals to k, then y would be f of k. So that's why this is a point which lies on this curve. Y equals to fx, or you can say this curve. Right? Now, the slope of this line, pq. Slope of this line would be b minus f of k upon a minus k. Right? Y minus y1. Y minus y1. X minus x1. Okay, so that's why y1 minus y1 upon x minus x1. This is the slope of the line, and we have one of the points, so we can calculate the equation of the line, which will be y minus b. Let's take this point y minus b and x minus a and write the slope here, which is b minus f of k upon a minus k. So this is the equation of normal from an external point to the curve y equals to fx. Now we are going to see the length of tangent, normal, subtangent and subnormal. Length of tangent, normal, subtangent and subnormal. The length of tangent, let's say PT, is equals to mod of k root of 1 plus 1 by m square. Okay. PN, let's say length of normal, that would be mod of k. M is the slope here. Okay. Which I told you earlier. 1 plus m square. Then TM, let's say it's the length of subtangent. Okay, T for tangent and for normal. Length of subtangent is mod of K by M. And length of subnormal, that would be MN, that is mod of KM. M can be negative, that's why we are doing mod and square. Okay, so that's the length of subnormal. Right, now we are going to see angle between two curves. These are the lengths of subtangent normal, because they are directly asked in the exam that what is the length if this is the slope and this is the point. Okay, so they will just ask you this and you will get to know the answer. Now, angle between two curves. Angle between two intersecting curves, let's say this, what is the angle between them? This is the angle between them. Okay, so it's defined as the acute angle between their tangents. Okay, these are the tangents, okay, at the point of intersection. So angle between, the acute angle between their tangents, this is the obtuse one, this is the acute one. So that angle at the point of intersection of the two curves. Okay, now tan theta, let's say this is theta, so tan theta is given as m1 minus m2 upon 1 plus m1 m2. It's just like the formula of trigonometry when we use tan of, let's say, alpha plus beta, which is equals to tan alpha, tan of alpha minus beta, alpha minus beta, tan alpha minus tan beta upon 1 plus tan alpha tan beta. Okay, and why is that? Because this is the slope, right? Now, alpha minus beta. Let's say this is something, this is the line. One tangent, tangent 1, and tangent 2. It has slope m1, it has slope m2. Now, let's say this is making, the t2 is making beta angle, this is making alpha angle. So, from the x-axis, okay? So, alpha minus beta would be theta, right? Because this is the angle between the tangents. So, that's why alpha minus beta will be theta. And tan alpha is what? m1. So, that's why this is m1 minus tan beta is m2. Because this is the slope for tangents upon 1 plus m1, m2. We just put us this determinant with modulus here because to get two values, because there will be one obtuse angle, then will be one this acute angle. So that's why there is a mod. Okay, so this is the formula. Tan theta is equal to m1 minus m2 and 1 plus m1 m2, where m1 and m2 are the slopes of the tangents at that point. Okay, that intersection point. Now we are going to see the shortest distance between two curves. Formula for shortest distance. The shortest distance between two non-intersecting differentiable curves, okay? Let's say this curve and this curve, or this curve. Shortest distance between these two curves, okay? That shortest distance is always along the common normal, okay? This is the normal. You first take the normal for this curve, f1x, then take the normal for this curve, find the equation. You must find the equation of two normals, and then what we are going to do, we are going to find the common normal along which the distance lies, okay? And we find the point, and then the distance between two points is what? Let's say a1 b1 and a2 b2 you find on the curves, then the distance between them will be root of b2 minus b1 whole square plus a2 minus a1 whole square. Okay, this will be the distance t. Okay, now we're going to read Rolle's theorem. This is one of the most important theorems. It is asked frequently, so we are going to read it. If a function f defined on a comma b, okay, f defined on a comma b is like, you can say this one. This is your a, this is your b, this is your function fx. Okay, now is continuous in this region, in this interval. Is derivable in this interval, or not this interval? Actually, it should be derivable in, except at this point, because we cannot say at this point it might not be differentiable. So that's why we put a open bracket in place of closed bracket. Derivable at this point, and f of a should be f of b. That means the curve should be like this, something like this, okay? And we cannot say this is differentiable at these points. If this is the condition, then there exists at least one real number C, let's say, this will be your C, between A and B, for which, or you can say such that, F dash C is 0, which you can see here, right? This F dash C is 0 at C point. So, they are saying that if there are two points, the thing is that the curve has to, you know, bind at some point in between that point, so that it's the slope at this point is zero, and that's why it will be a maximum or minimum, something like that. Rolle's theorem says that, right? So the main condition is this: f dash is zero. If f is defined, if a function is defined on this interval, if it's continuous in this interval, derivable in this interval, and f is equals to fb, this is the most important condition for this, then there exists at least one real number c between a and b such that f dash c is zero. Or you can say c is this between a and b. Alright? Now we are going to read the Lagrange theorem for Lagrange mean value theorem. Lagrange's mean value theorem, which is also said LMVT. Okay? Now, it says that if a function f is defined on a to b is, if a function defined on a to b is first, let's say, continuous on, of course, the full interval, then you can say derivable on open intervals. Okay, this is the condition. Then there exist only these two conditions. Lagrange shorted the third condition. He proposed something new. Then there exists at least, again the same definition, one real number between a and b such that fb minus fa, okay, function at b minus function at a upon b minus a, that would be f dash c, and c is such that a to b. So this is the condition for Lagrange. Okay, so in this equation we are using the differentiation part, f dash c, which is equals to fb minus fa upon b minus a, right? So this is the Lagrange mean value theorem. This is of course the mean value. Okay, fb minus fa, if the value of function, it can be anything. This is fb, this is fa, at this a and this b, fa and fb, and you have to, you know, the interval is the function's value is divided by the interval a to b, so that will give you the mean value. And so this is called Lagrange's mean value theorem. So this is the way to learn: fb minus fa upon b minus a is equals to f dash c. Fine. Here we complete our application of derivatives.